Hello, everybody, and welcome back to the One Nation of Gamers 2016 circuit. We're about to jump into the final match of Future Tournament number 2 to determine the champion. Once again, I'm TJ, and I am joined by That's Admirable. Nathan, That's Admirable Zamora, champion of the West.
Is that what they call me?
That's what they call you on the streets.
That's right. I am the champion of the West. Zero tournament victories thus far in Hearthstone, but plenty of top eights and top 16s in the big Blizzard events, but not quite that big finish I'm looking for.
All right, well, I know two people that are looking for that big finish, and that's going to be Zalay and Dog. They've had, you know, some good finishes, but I know they want to add one more onto that resume, and I know exactly what tournament that one more is, and that's the Feature Tournament number 2 of the 2016 One Nation of Gamers circuit. And they also want to qualify for PAX and win that as well. It's a $25,000 premier tournament, so lots on the line for these players. The difference between first and second place is $3,000 for first, $1,500 for second, and of course that PAX Prime qualification. So I'd say this is a pretty big deal, Admirable.
Yeah, and they're looking to take the lead in their lifetime matches as well. Two matches apiece for them in the past. So the winner of this one takes that 3-2 lead in matchups. And to me, that's the more important one, is being able to say, hey, I've won more than you than we've met in the past.
Yeah,
think about that. let that loom over your head for a second.
Yeah, and another thing, these two players were the two invited players. So one thing that I like to keep track of is how many of the open players make it into the finals and how many of the invited players. And so far, it's been a large mix. You know, over the course of the last season, the circuit in 2015 for One Nation of Gamers, and if you look back at the first feature tournament for 2016, it's been a good mix. We have Eversiction, who's already qualified. He made it through an open tournament. So now, I guess now we have two invited players in here. It's only fitting that for the second feature, we have an invited player to make it in. So I'm looking for that really strong lineup to see at PAX Prime for that finals at the end of the year. And I would love to see either Zalay or Dog make it into that group of players.
Yeah, anytime you see these two competing in an event, you know, they're always a threat to win the whole thing. And when I talk about threat to win the whole thing, I don't mean like, oh, yeah, sure, anyone can win the event. It's Hearthstone. I mean, if I have to pick a player who I think is going to win, these two guys' names pop to the forefront of my mind. They've just had such fantastic years in the last two. Zalay was actually number one in points in 2015. Dog has just been on fire since last summer, putting up finish after finish. And Zalay just continues to improve his play. He's one of the strongest technical players out there, I think. He's never going to shy away from being patient. He's not someone who's going to get rushed. He doesn't get tilted. As far as the mental aspect is concerned, he might be the strongest mental player that's out there. But in terms of finishes right now, Dog has just been on fire for months on end.
Yeah, even like last season, I believe he got a top 100 finish in March, which for a player that streams as much as he does is pretty cool.
Yeah, not only did he get that top 100 finish, but actually in the closing hours, you'll find a lot of people who are top 100, they just wait. There's no incentive for them to play.
They don't
Dog
queue,
was
yeah.
just streaming his matches, playing in the top 25 with no delay. He was just playing.
Yeah, he was like at 22, and he was streaming. He was at 22. There was like 45 minutes left. He's like, you know what? I'm gonna queue. Like, who does that? Like, you're only gonna gain like 5 points by like winning again, and you're gonna lose like 60 if you lose a match at that rating that close to the end of the season. So, bold call by him. And I really like his sort of attitude and his play style. But we're going to jump into the first match here. It's going to be Dog's mid-range Paladin versus Zalay's Secret Paladin.
Yeah, this is one I don't have a ton of experience with. I mean, if you're familiar with me at all, I'm not a big fan of the slower decks right now. I think that the aggro decks are so strong, and it's very difficult to justify not playing them. But Dog has brought quite a wealth of control decks into his lineup, and he's been doing great with them so far. And this could be one of the reasons why. I mean, this turn, you know, it's looking good for Zalay. Does get to chip this board a little bit. But Dog really has kind of the control over this game right now, I'd say. I mean, Zalay has two copies of Coghammer in hand. Does have Mysterious Challenger here on 5. But Dog has got Consecrate. He's got Iron Beak Owl. He's got Aldor Peacekeeper in his hand. I mean, what is actually a threat versus him right now?
Nothing. And that's what it seems like with mid-range Paladin. They just have so many ways to just remove. If, they have outdoor peacekeepers to just sort of stall. And then eventually, if you make it past all that stuff, and you get past the owl, you get past the owl door, those are quality consecrate your board, and you have to start from scratch. So,
wow.
This deck's been performing extremely well for Dog over the course of the weekend.
Picks up the Big Game Hunter here, too. So if he can find a way to actually proc the Noble Sacrifice while the Mysterious Challenger is isolated, he's got another answer to that. I mean, it's looking pretty good for him, but this turn, he's actually agonizing over this one a bit. I think he's reluctant to play this Aldor Peacekeeper, but it's looking like the play to me.
Yeah. He knows, well, I don't know. I was going to say he knows that he has a play for Mysterious Challenger. I suppose he still does. Depends where this Avenge falls, I guess, if Zelite does decide to play Mysterious Challenger. If it falls on the Keeper of Alderman, then all of a sudden there's no BGH target, and that Keeper of Alderman is going to prove to be an issue.
Yeah, this went from like the 50% chance for Dog to have, I'm sorry, for the 100% chance for Dog to have a great position to suddenly 50% chance. And I think that's where the expression came from, is he knows that he's vulnerable in this spot. Picks up second Elder Peacekeeper, though.
Ooh, so that means he has an out no matter what, but he still wants this to go on to the Monsieur Shell. Andre, let's see.
Oh, and it does. Great turn now from Dog. I mean, this went from potentially like a close, tough turn for him to suddenly he is so far ahead at this point. And you can see it in Zalay's face, too. He's like, yep, this is pretty much the one thing I didn't want to happen. And the fact that he drew Redemption on the turn he played the turn before he played the Mysterious Challenger too, that's a big setback to him. It's the difference between having a 6-1 and having not a 6-1 on the table right now.
Yeah, losing your board here as the Secret Paladin is one of the worst things that can happen, because it's so hard for you to reload. Especially if you have something that's isolated, it makes it so easy for the mid-range Paladin to just remove.
Yep. Still plenty of play this turn for Zalay, though. I mean, Dog's kind of lacking action, honestly. The one thing he doesn't have is a big threat right now. Time is really, I feel like, the biggest threat from Dog. If he's able to extend the game long enough, it's got to be massively in his favor.
Yeah. I'd say so. And Zalay just doesn't know what to do here. I mean, Coghammer, you got to get those rolling. I think it's whether or not he wants to sort of like play the Knife Juggler first, maybe, or even hold on to the Knife Juggler potentially. But since he's going to play the Redemption, he wants to make sure that he has good targets on the board to get redeemed.
Yeah, just leaves the 1-1 up. Not really too big of a deal for him. And Dog just draws more heal. I mean, no threat this turn is kind of an issue.
Yeah, it is. I mean, you give a free turn over to Zalay to do it whatever he wants with. And, I mean, you're going into turn 7. You can only expect. Mysterious Challenger was played. It's in the deck. Dr. Boom's coming.
Yeah, that's really the big advantage I think that Secret Paladin has, is past turn 6, their card quality just goes way up if they played Mysterious Challenger.
Yeah.
Second Keeper of Uldamon. I mean, this might be a second Coghammer here for Zalay. I don't know, though. I mean, with the way that panned out, he may just be eyeing the Lotheb and thinking this could be his turn to push.
And I think he's got to go for it.
That's a nice juggle. Hitting that antique heal bot.
Might be turning around a little bit.
Yeah. Using the 2-4 to clear here, I don't mind this. The Knife Juggler, though, I think this is pointing at the dome. Yeah. This is looking rough. Aldor Peacekeeper can cut into the damage a bit, but he's losing the board position. And that's something that's very dangerous, is that if this builds too much, it's just going to be overwhelming. I mean, sure, he's got Lailhands. Sure, he's got Consecrate. But this is the spot where if Zalay starts drawing his big threats, Dog's in a lot of trouble.
Yes, he is. And you don't want to just throw all of your threats out, because you know that your outs in this situation are sort of like board clears. And if you just throw your stuff out to get killed, then it makes like the board clears feel less good, because you don't have the stuff to reload. So I like that he just sort of holds on to the knife juggler here, because that can get a lot more value as the game goes on. You know, if he draws into a muster for battle, if he draws into a board clear and can reload, the knife juggler is going to come into play. And that, the two juggles that he would get from playing it that turn would probably be inconsequential. So I like that he holds on to it.
More sniping juggles here from Zelay. He's had high percent chance to make a big impact to the knife juggler. He finally misses one, but...
I don't know if that's a miss. I think anything that goes to the face is right on target.
Just take the damage. Why not?
Yeah.
We don't need to kill minions. Yeah, 1-1's going to bite the dust here. And it's looking like Lothab's lined up in that other 1-1 as well. Just keep your board protected and start hammering away. Mm-hmm. And that knife juggler is actually, in the face of Consecrate, it's going to be the first one to die. So it even has a redemption set up for the knife juggler at this point. And I don't think Dog has an option. He's just got to lay on hands.
Got to find that equality.
And just more, 11 points of damage here, too.
Yeah, at this point, it's a necessity. Finds a zombie chow. That little guy's going to do his best to fight back on this board.
Yeah, this is going to be a really tough one to fight back with, though. Zelay's about to have 7 minions in play.
He's also going to push so much damage this turn.
Yeah, this is looking ugly for Dog, that's for sure. This is that first juggle. I mean, maybe it's not a miss, I don't know. It's tough to tell what he wants. I mean, I imagine he wants to kill the zombie chow here.
Yeah. He just wants at least one of those juggles to hit the zombie chow. That's what he's looking for.
Anytime Pilot Shredder attacks and it's unchecked, it is a miserable feeling. Dog pretty much needs equality right here.
Yeah.
Even equality, it doesn't even really answer the entire board, though. I mean, Dog's getting a 3-1 back. He's got a 2-2 shield. He's got a 1-4 shield. He's got a Piloted Shredder drop. He's got Keeper Voldemort in his hand.
I mean, he could silence and then equality consecrate, so he can eliminate some of this. Some of the residual damage.
What if there's ever an argument for equality and knife juggler?
There's a lot of stuff on board. That knife juggler can... I mean, if it hits either of the Divine Shields and then hits, like, the Piloted Shredder, you're looking at a rough spot, especially since it hits Piloted Shredder first. Knife juggler could come out and hit it. So, okay, it doesn't even use the Iron Beguile. So, just going to go ahead and take whatever comes out of this Piloted Shredder.
Yep, there's the Redemption. 3-1. 2-1 back behind this. And knife juggler's not looking so bad here. Ooh, snipes at 3-1 too.
Best target.
Oh gosh. That is a disgusting good draw.
You talked about earlier that Zelay loves to ask himself questions, and I'm sure as soon as that came out, he's like, is that good?
Is this one okay?
Is this good?
Is this the one I needed? So I feel like this was the one I needed.
I think it's pretty good.
Yeah, it's okay. I guess I'll play Dr. Boom. Whew. Wow. I mean, this is almost completely lights out at this point. Dog's down to 12. You're looking at maximum 2 cards he can play in a single turn, and none of them really affect the board state. I mean, Tyrion's a big taunt. It gives you Ashbringer, but when your opponent's out of range and you're the one getting beat down, that Tyrion does not look nearly as good.
Yeah. You know, he's got to play it just to sort of fight back here, but yeah, is it too late? Silence is a boom, but oh, man. That never feels good.
Keeper Voldemort can chew this damage, too. Is this lethal here?
I think it is with Keeper, because you can throw that. You can throw one of the 1-1s in, guarantee that that last boom bot goes to face.
Yeah, I think this is lethal here.
Yeah.
7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Yep. Even regardless of where the boombot goes, it's lethal.
Yeah. And that's going to be Zelay taking game number 1 in a grueling match. You know,
Well, this is lethal. I think Zelay's just counting it 4 or 5 times to make sure.
Yeah, he could have guaranteed that boombot went face. But, you know, it doesn't matter at all. So, just double-checking. And, yeah, Zelay takes game number 1.
Very clean game for him. I mean, that Dr. Boo pickup was just so sick. I mean, granted, second Mysterious Challenger is pretty good. His own Tyrion draw is fantastic as well. We haven't seen Ragnaros from him, but that's not to say it's not in the build. He does have two copies of Coghammer. I would tend to say it's probably not in the build when I see two Coghammers, but either way, you know, fairly high threat density towards the end, but Dr. Boom was just the lights out one. I mean, there was no coming back for Dog after that one.
Yeah,
already for used sure. Both outdoor peacekeepers, already used Capable Demonic. Quality was down.
All right, well, Dog, you know, it's hard to tell how these lineups match up against each other. Dog's got some interesting decks here with lots of control. He's got Demon Handlock. He's got what we assumed was Malygos Rogue, looking at the list that he threw out there. So he's just sort of got what's good. You know, he's got the decks that are probably the strongest right now. He's got Seeker Paladin. He's got Control Warrior. He's got Aggro Shaman. These are all decks that are just strong right now.
And that's typically the kind of player he is. You know, he's not very fancy on his lineups. He's just going to play the decks that he has the highest win rates with. It's been very, very successful with him in his career so far. You know, I don't blame anyone for taking that route. And yeah. Wow, what an opener for Zalay here.
Whew. Yeah, that's what you want. Is you just want minions to fight. You never want to be stuck with a handful of spells early on, and these Leopard Gnomes are going to get so much damage, especially since Dog doesn't even have a solid turn 2 play. He doesn't have, like, a Haunted Creeper. Oh, well, hey! He does have a Shielded Minibot. Spoke too soon there.
Sometimes. Yeah, Dog, I think his plays are pretty much spelled out. I'm sorry, for Zalay, I think his plays are fairly spelled out here, though. I mean, this is just going to be a damage push, I imagine.
Yeah.
He knows that Muster for Battle is very likely here, so he's going to eye what the Haunted Creeper looks like. Man, I'm Totem Golem all the way right here. Now, it does affect his curve a little bit, though. If he plays the Totem Golem, he's not getting the Abusive Sergeant on board. So, actually, the Haunted Creeper, I think, is a little bit better because of that.
It still means that the minion you're putting on the board is a lot weaker. But it's a possibility. Man, that Shielded Minibot made things so much better, I feel.
Oh, yeah. I mean, this went from Dog just dying early on to what's happening to suddenly have a realistic chance to win this game, and that's a pretty fantastic draw as well.
But what do you go for? Okay, yeah, Knife Juggler, Abusive Sergeant. There is a potential for a board clear here, and protecting the Knife Juggler could be a big deal. Just diversifying your assets. That's not where you want to go.
Sometimes
it's not where you want it to go, but sometimes I think that's where you want it to go. Doc's already at 18 health. You know he's going to trade this board, but I guess you wanted to preserve that Knife Juggler. And that's the thing that I think Zalay's probably said about the most. And Zalay actually just smiles and shakes it off. One thing to note is the players can actually see each other's reactions. They're actually sort of in the program we use, they're in a sort of room together where they can both just see their cameras side by side. Which is a cool thing. It sort of simulates them being across from each other in like a LAN environment, so they can see each other's reactions. So poker faces matter.
Yep. I love that feel too. I love when I can see my opponent.
Mm-hmm.
You know, against
watch
these
them
two,
sweat.
Against these two, I would say the facial reactions. You know, they probably have a good control over what's going on. Mm-hmm. Maybe even sending fake signals at times. So I would tend to not pay attention to it. But I've definitely been to some tournaments where against weaker opponents, I pick up on some of the physical movements they make. I can tell when they're uncomfortable about something, and I'll take that opportunity to push the action.
Yeah.
But here, yeah, the crackle is such an undesired play from Zalay, because in addition to having the failure rate, he's also like super weak to True Silver Champion now, and he's also pretty weak against Sludge Belcher, and Dog just happens to have both of them.
Yeah, and now he just doesn't have burn also. So that's going to be his downfall as well.
This is definitely the kind of opening you want if you're Dog. Like, the juggles just went so well for him. And just Aldor Peacekeeper. Doesn't really have to do anything. Just save the Sludge Belcher for Doomhammer if you can. It's, like, such a good follow-up to that play.
Yeah.
And this might just be... I mean, this might be face damage and hope at this point.
Yeah, that seems like so many Aggro Shaman games are, you know, face damage and hope. You get to a certain point Like, by turn six, it's like, ah, well, at this point, I just can't trade. So I'm just going face, and I'm hoping.
I do like his trade here, though. Dog at 15. There's still a chance here for this reach to happen. Can't kill the totem this turn. And so the Flame Tongue is, you know, potentially threatening some damage here. But that Sludge Belcher is quickly going to bring that to a halt.
Yeah. And I don't know if Zoli's going to have enough to push through this. This is going to be a lot of health to get through with not very many resources. He's going to have Flame Tongue to sort of trade back here. But
wow.
Ooh.
Dog actually going to go with this. And this opens him to this damage now.
Feral Spirits can also be pretty good. At the very least, it buys time for more burn, I suppose. But Midrange Paladin, you can't really hope that burn's going to stick as much. They have a lot more heals. They have Lay on Hands. They have Anti-Heal Bot. And they do have like threats to plot behind those heals. So I still think Dog's in a favorable position. But if Zalei pushes damage now and then draws some burn, he could change. This could change around a little bit.
I still think he's debating the trades a bit here. But I don't see them happening. You know, I guess the other option is, do you totem first or totem second? You know, the positioning on those could potentially matter with the Flame Tongue on board.
Yeah. It's a really tough call. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Here we go, boys.
Send it up.
Wow. Actually gonna trade here. Really interesting.
Especially since that Flame Tongue Totem's looking awfully lonely over there on the far left.
I think it's the new term for isolated buffs like that. Like Direwolf Alpha, he's a lonely Direwolf Alpha.
Yeah.
He needs his pack with him.
Awfully lonely. There's one thing that a Flame Tongue Totem needs in life, and that's a friend to the left. Beyonce knew it well.
I'm thinking of that the Toy Story song.
You got a friend in me?
Yep.
Yeah.
Overload continues to be a little bit of an issue. Not missing too much. I mean, the totems don't really mean that much in this matchup. You know, it's really like get on the ground running, hope that you burn to follow up.
Yeah.
And Zalei's early game got disrupted so hard. And it's really on that shielded minibot that Dog drew. If he didn't draw shielded minibot, I think he was actually in bad shape this game.
Yeah. Because the difference between having the hero power of that and having an extra 2/2 on the board to fight against, you know, the extra tokens that were spawning is a pretty big deal, I'd say. So now, what's interesting is that Zalei has a Paladin Shredder in his Aggro Shaman deck. It's good because if you're running the Flameton Totems, because it gives you sort of a more likely to have something on the board for the follow-up turn, but by itself, it doesn't have an immediate impact. It's sort of in a similar vein as Totem Golem, I guess, but it doesn't come out nearly as early.
Yeah, I'm just going to try to make use of what he can, but at the end of the day, I think this one's just it's a lost cause. Dog's just got all the answers. Now, I say that, and two burn spells can just change everything, but Zalei doesn't strike me as an Ancestral Knowledge player. Especially when he's got Pilot Shredder. Where does the room come in?
Yeah. Ancestral Knowledge is not included in a lot of lists. I think you were maybe one of the players who used to not put it in. I'm not sure if you've changed your ways.
Yeah, I'm pretty much... I've been playing one copy recently. I'm not sure how happy I am with it, but Zalei just even going to choose to play the big game hunter here. Run over his punt stuff. And yeah, that's not good enough.
Need a board for that.
It's a lonely, abusive sergeant.
He doesn't care which side his friend's on, though.
That's true.
He'll conform.
Yeah, Dr. Boomman up to the table. Four swinging across. I think this is a two-turn closeout here from Dog. Even going to swing the True Silver Champion here. Plays around Double Crackle, even though Zalei can't have that. Does play around Lava Burst and Crackle as well. Mm-hmm. 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. One damage off for Dog this turn.
Spell Power Totem plus Lava Burst plus Crackle was a potential lethal. exactly 13 damage with highest roll crackle. But, yeah.
Oh.
It's one damage off, actually.
Why not?
Yeah, you might as well. You can even get Boombot. You can even get Boombot lethal here. But you land hand seems like the right course of action. And even picks up an anti-kill bot. And Zlay goes ahead and concedes. And that means the series is all tied up at one apiece. We've had some close series today overall. And we'll have to see. Both players taking just wins with their Paladins. That seems to be a trend also throughout the day here. Paladin very successful.
Yeah, it's always pretty much a good tournament deck. You know, it's matchups that it's weak in. It's not too weak in, aside from, like, maybe Freeze Mage. And then the rest of them, if you just get strong enough draws, Paladin can just win. And that's part of the appeal, I think, of this deck in tournaments, is that it doesn't really have too many weak spots, I feel like. You know, if your opponent's going to build an entire lineup for it, especially in a best-of-seven format, that means they need to bring five decks that are potentially strong against Paladin. It's really difficult to isolate in most of those situations.
Especially just most decks, it just has that 50% win rate against, at least. Like, it's even our favorite against almost everything out there.
Yeah. So, it's going to be Zoo versus Control Warrior for... Zoo for Zalay and Control Warrior for Dog. And what an opening hand a Dog has. I mean, you can't ask for much more when you're playing against Zoo.
You can't really. Ash plus the Fiery War Axe is great. You can even hold on to a Brawl. You know, because that card's always going to have a good use. It's a little bit slower, but...
He's actually going to keep all four cards. Yeah, unless he just mulligans so fast that we can see him.
Which sometimes Dog does. So, you can never always guarantee that. That's the case, so...
Now, we do see a twist here. Zalay is bringing a Hobgoblin. And this is kind of like... This is almost like one of his signature cards. I know he plays this list a ton. And it brings a very different dynamic to this. You know, if you get to a board position where you can load up on a bunch of one-power minions and have the buff swing to every single one of them from the Hobgoblin, that can put a lot of pressure on players.
That it can.
That could be the reason why Dog kept the Brawl in his hand, knowing that Zalay is potentially bringing this build. Goldshire Footman may even be the take here.
Oh, man, I love it. I love it. Goldshire Footman. I think that's Goldshire Footman, you get the value of the taunt. I guess Slowly Squire, you can buff it up first and then, you know, get that continued buff with the hero power, but Goldshire Footman ain't getting much better.
He's ready for action. He's just playing it this turn.
On a scale of 1 to ready for action, how ready for action are you?
Goldshire Footman. Yeah, this is going to be a sudden stop to this, though. Dog's got Deathlord in his hand. When I'm playing these aggro decks, I've noticed that when Warrior goes Fiery War Axe Deathlord, I have like an almost 0% win rate.
Yeah. Give or take, right around a few zeros. Okay, let's see.
However, Warming Abuse Sergeant's a pretty good answer to that, though.
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll see an extra minion from this as well. Maybe squeeze a Hobgoblin. Ooh.
Ooh, that'd be spicy.
That'd be tingly.
Better Vargas, not the best.
Same stats, though.
I prefer almost anything else.
I think he would have wanted a Sea Giant here.
Yeah.
That'd be okay. Ooh, second Fiery War Axe. Dog just chewing through these minions. With Slam and Bash, he still has yet to use them. How's Zalay going to get a presence this game? Well, that may be a way.
I don't even know.
Jam that Lotha, let's go.
Yeah. So this matchup, how does Hobgoblin Zoo fare better against the Control Warrior? Than the normal Zoo? I feel like you can't reload as well. I don't know. It's hard to tell.
Yeah, I would say not. You know, Brawl is just so effective versus you, and you're missing some of that endgame burst that you normally have. You know, like you think Leroy Jenkins, you think Doomguard, and typical Zoo decks. You certainly fight a lot better against I think, minion to minion action.
Yeah.
But, I mean, look at this. Two Sea Giants now. There's just nothing to play. Is he, I mean, does he Hobgoblin here?
I mean, you might as well use one of them, right? Like, if
no, I don't think you might as well.
If you ask me, like, if you have four cards in your hand, what are the two cards that you have two of that you would want the least? And I would probably say, well, Hobgoblin and Sea Giant, easy.
Deathwing.
Four Deathwings?
Clockwork Giant.
Yeah, I guess so. You got me there.
I can keep going. Priests of Elune?
Goldshire Footman?
I think Zalay would like a couple of Goldshire Footmen right now. He's got two copies of Hobgoblin.
Yeah, I played a game the other day where I had a Deathbite equipped and no cards left, and I was playing against the Tempo Mage, and I was like, okay, I win 100% next turn. He Unstable Portals a Priestess of Elune to bring himself up to 5, and I couldn't lethal him.
Yes.
So Priestess of Elune, those things are... those things are sick.
Yep, clear board for Zalay. And 2 10 mana Sea Giants in hand. I think this might be Hobgoblin, Voidwalker.
They work against each other because you can't play the Sea Giants because you have too many because you don't have anything on the board. But you also just have Hobgoblins, but you don't want to play your Hobgoblins. Alright. Well, there it is.
No goblins or gnomes this turn, just a Voidwalker. Just a Voidwalker. Just a 5/7 taunt.
Yeah, I think there was a 5/7 revealed today. A 5/7 taunt revealed today. Something Arakoa. Corrupted Arakoa, perhaps. Druid class card.
+3/+3 to your C'Thun, wherever it is.
Wherever it is. Doesn't matter.
I love that card. That's going to make me play C'Thun. Dark Arakoa is the name of that one. It just came to me.
What I want to know, what I've been thinking about for a long time, is what if your opponent steals your C'Thun with Sylvanas? Is it still your C'Thun?
No, it's not. They stole it. It's theirs. It's legally their property.
Whoa! Okay. Whoa! Hello. That's what I'm talking about. Do you go all in though?
It is running right in a brawl, which I think Zalay thinks that Dog doesn't have given last turn. I mean, Deathbite attack of 5/7 bash was not super strong. And he's loading everything on the board.
Yeah. But he's at 9 health now, so yeah, I mean, if he brawls and a 5/7 comes out of this, then he has to attack into it and revenge in order to clear it off the board.
Ooh.
Okay.
It's still kind of a brutal attack, though. I mean, you're at 9. Ugh. This one's going to be close. 2 Sea Giants in hand. I don't think Zalay's hand can be possibly worse right now. I think he'd actually like those Priestess of Elune a little bit more.
What about 3 Sea Giants?
Oh, gosh.
That's not looking good. I mean, I think you at this point you even just keep the Knife Juggler.
If you implosion your own Knife Juggler, do you get the juggles?
Yeah. Right? Yeah, I think so.
I don't know. I've never been in that situation.
Wait, can you even implosion your own minions?
Yep.
Okay. I don't know. I've never been in that situation.
That one, I've no, I'm sure. I've implosioned my own eggs so often.
Yeah.
I never draw an activator.
Yeah. Implosion's I've also implosioned Divine Shields before. Those are embarrassing. The first time's embarrassing. The second time...
That's just Artosis.
Just like, I just quit. I quit Hearthstone.
You know, he tried to execute his own Sylvanas twice.
Oh, yeah?
Did you know that? The first time is funny, but the second time, like, I was like, you experienced this like a week ago.
We're talking about the 2013 Hearthstone World Champion. Wait, no. It was 2013
yeah.
Hearthstone World Champion.
That's right, EU. We're up 2 world champions to 1 right now.
That's right. That's right. Asia and Asia Pacific. The rest of the world is up 3-0.
Revenge, clear off that little Knife Juggler, and Dr. Boom.
All right. Well, you can double implosion the Dr. Boom, and maybe... If you double implosion the Dr. Boom, there's a high likelihood that you can play both Sea Giants.
Also, Dr. Boom lives.
And if the Dr. Boom dies, if you roll a 3 and then a 4, uh-oh, or a 4 and then a 3, uh-oh, he rolled a 3, he killed it, oh, no. Well, I say oh no, but I guess that's a good thing.
Dog's kind of fighting for his life here still. I mean, the 1-1s are still a threat. And not like a little one. I mean, he does have Deathbite to start to keep the damage high, but... I can take the hit. Yeah, can't blame him for this one. 14. What could kill him here? It would take a lot. Oh.
Well, the thing is...
Uh-oh.
Zalae's now at 14 himself, which means that Deathbite plus a Grom kills him. So that means he might be even more inclined to... play the Defender of Argus to play around that, but I don't know how he's feeling right now about the chances that dog does have that lethal potential. Oh, this is tough. This is real tough. And then you have to, I mean, I guess, can you play everything? So 4, then it'll cost 3, and then it'll cost 2. So 4 plus 3 plus 2 is 9. So he can play everything. Oh, no, he can't, because he has to trade something in. He doesn't have the board space. Yikes.
It's got to move. It's going to go for Life Tap here. Oh, I needed the time to think about this. Yeah, very effective trades here, though.
Yeah, I like that. I think he found a good spot as long as he gets that last attack into the face, and he doesn't miss 2 damage.
We'll see if that... looks embarrassed too. That's something I don't think I've ever seen happen to Zalae too. Is that situation double shield block? Oh my gosh!
Well, all of a sudden, Dog's back at like 30 health as this turn. After this turn, he's even gonna have the next shield block for next turn. So he's gonna BGH this off. Still though, I mean, there's an opportunity. Dog's out of stuff. He's got the Death Bite, but he doesn't have removal left, and Zalae still has that second Sea Giant. So at this point, you can't afford not to tap. You can't play the Imp Gang boss plus the Sea Giant. So you can play Argent Squire plus Sea Giant and then trade in.
I mean, it's got to be the play, right? And your opponent just used basically everything they've got left.
Yeah. And then you're trading in the Defender of Argus. I think preserving that taunt's worth more. Yeah. All right, well, this is sort of those situations where this matchup comes down to, where it's not necessarily... Ooh, the execute! Oh my goodness.
You know what? No presence this turn. So Zalae has a couple turns here to Life Tap, but he's going to need these next minions to bring some heat. He's out of Sea Giants, he's out of Hobgoblins, and now is when all the 1-1s start flowing in. 2 Imp Gang bosses definitely welcome at this point. But this is going to be tight. I mean, if Dog can pick up some damage, like if Dog draws Deathbite, he's threatening lethal.
Yeah, and just load it up.
Ways to go on this one. So he's hoping that Dog just kind of just draws puny cards for the rest of the game.
He's still a long ways away, though. That's just 7 damage on the... Oh, the...
What?
Are you kidding me? And oh Dog is just like, no reaction. He's like, what up? What up? I got a big brawl. Nerubian Egg is...
just on time.
Yeah.
A Nerubian Egg shows up precisely when he means to, TJ.
Well, I mean, Dog, all he has to do, there's only 2 damage represented on the board. He can just armor up for days. Eventually, he's just going to tap himself to death. It's only a matter of time before Dog just picks up a Grom Hellscream, am I right? Like, he still has that in his deck. I don't think he...
That's quite lethal at this point, too.
Yeah.
I don't think Santa's got the time for this. We're going to find out. Dog still has to draw the right cards, but he's in fantastic shape to do so. Shield Slam for the Knife Juggler. And Sludge Belcher is going to back this up very nicely. Now even for the Nerubian instead.
Yeah. Well.
Second pick, Power Overwhelming. Zalae only has 1 card left.
What is it even?
Second PO?
Okay, well, it's a Haunted Creeper. And that's going to do it. So Zalay, unfortunately, not going to be able to piece together a victory here. That was some timely removal from Dog towards the end there. Some key brawls, and I won that matchup. There was a scary moment where he could have been dead the next turn if he hadn't gotten that brawl, if he hadn't won that brawl correctly early on when there was double Hobgoblin plus a double 5/7 Voidwalker. But Dog's got to be feeling comfortable now that he's got a lead.
Yeah, I think picking up that win, that's certainly an easier Zoodeck, I think, for Dog to fend off. But that win's got to feel so comfortable now.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, just this is going to be an uphill battle from this point. Rogue versus Zoo.
Yeah, I was going to say, now he's got Rogue, which, if there's one deck that you want to go up against Zoo, it's a deck that, one, you feel comfortable playing, and two, a Rogue. So this is just right up Dog's wheelhouse. I'm sure he plays this deck a lot on ladder, which means he runs into Zoo all the time. Maybe Hobgoblin throws a wrench into the plans, but I like Dog's chances here.
Yeah, this is a bit of a different Zoo deck, though. I mean, I'm curious how much the Hobgoblins actually affect this matchup.
Ooh. Mm-hmm. Bloodsail Corsair could have some clutch use. And he is going to pick it up. There is a, usually in this deck, if it is Malygos Warlock, or sorry, not Malygos Warlock, Malygos Rogue, they usually only run two weapon buffs. A lot of times you can just stop them from, you know, removing a key creature from your board by playing Bloodsail Corsair onto even just a one durability non-buff dagger.
Yeah. Just a little bit of tempo can make all the difference here, but this is going to be a strong turn here from Dog. Zalay needs a big implosion right here. But even in the face of that, I mean, he's facing down Phantom Knives from Dog. Just the potential of Phantom Knives really makes this implosion unappealing. I think he's got to go for it anyway, but...
Got him! Oh, man. Well, that ends up being a pretty big deal, because that means his Imp Gang boss survives another day, even through Phantom Knives. So I guess that's just revenge for Dog's brawls in the last match. I mean, each player has had some pretty good fortune and some pretty poor fortune so far throughout this series. I don't think we can give the RNG award over to any player as it stands.
Sapcoin fan, looking pretty appealing at this point.
Yeah, just buying time, stopping the board, that's a big deal. Sapon in-game boss doesn't seem that appealing, but you know, when you're forcing them to spend 3 mana to plop down a 2/4 on the board, yeah, those are the kinds of things that you look for.
Yeah, Echoing Ooze is just going to be the play here. Just trying to get any presence on board to start attacking Dog. Dog, no spells left in his hand, though, just minions. This is the potentially dangerous spot, is when you don't have utility that interacts very well.
Okay, well, he gets a backstab.
This is like Power Overwhelming and Lothab here.
Yeah.
I mean, Zalay definitely wants to kill that Azure Drake. He's going to take his time to think about everything here, though.
All right, so is there any other way to do it? I mean, what is he... He could just Sea Giant.
I mean, he just saw a sap, too. I mean, maybe Sea Giant's the play. When you play Sea Giant, your opponent... Say they don't have sap next turn.
Yeah, I guess the one thing that you're looking at is... Lothab reduces the clock. You still push, like, almost as much damage the following turn, except you lock them out of spells, so they may be able to develop... but they can't push. Your board's protected, so Sea Giant is going to be just as cheap the next turn. So, you know, I think about it again, I think Lothab seems like the right choice, so I like how he went with that one.
Yeah, no room for two cards this turn either.
And if you tap, there's no way that you can play the Sea Giant.
Yeah, this is tough.
Hmm.
And that Emperor's got, I mean, it's got a pretty big target on its forehead. This is pretty much a priority kill.
Hmm.
Yep, Sea Giant trade it is.
Come on and slam.
Welcome to the jam. Pretty much the perfect turn here for Dog as well. Azure Drake, backstab, eviscerate, takes care of that Sea Giant.
He might feel like he wants to draw, though, but I don't know if you can really afford to. This matchup is not necessarily about drawing into your stuff. It's more about just, like, continuing to remove the board. Because eventually, you're going to have an Azure Drake on the board, and they aren't going to have anything. And that Azure Drake's going to start getting into damage. And so you don't necessarily want to make those big gadget stand turns. You just want to keep removing the board. And that's exactly what Dog's going to do. He's played this matchup plenty of times. So he's got the experience necessary, it feels.
Yeah, Defender Vargas, a little bit weak here. God, just Andrzejczyk's so good, isn't it?
Yeah. I was talking the other day, I think it was Crip, about how, would you play a 6-mana 5/5 draw one card, Battlecry draw one card?
Potentially, just the right situation.
Yeah.
Oh!
Hello!
The hits keep coming to you, even prep for the fan afterwards.
Did somebody say full clear? I just did. Me. I just did right now.
I did it. That was me who said that. Hey, why not?
Yeah, did somebody say draw a card? Also me.
I said them both.
Yeah.
That was me.
And there we go.
Yeah, Dog kind of cringing at that play. I definitely agree, too. I think this was missequenced pretty poorly from him. I don't think you need to use second poison. I think that Blade Flurry Prep Fan would have been a little bit stronger here for him. But unfortunately for his delay, just no way to capitalize on it. Yeah, Dog starting to look back at this turn and go, I thought I was clearing the entire board. It's not too big of a deal, but vulnerability to second power overwhelming, that's like really, I think, his only concern with this turn. I mean, at 15, he's pretty safe from all the burst damage.
Yeah. And here it goes. Zalae's just going to haul in. He's seen both poisons, which is the only weapon buffs that Malygos rogues usually run. And it doesn't matter now that he's not getting by this Bloodsail Corsair. So he's just going to throw it out there, go all in on the board, and we'll see if he's going to be able to push it through. Dog's picking up some pretty good stuff, though.
This is all going to get chewed apart. This is brutal. This is always tough to watch. Watching an aggro player lose all their minions, it pains me, TJ.
Does it?
Yes.
It pains me, too. You know, I have a lot of respect for players that bring aggro to tournaments. I didn't used to. But then I saw the light.
Yeah, just so many cards getting drawn.
Yeah. Throw out the Sinister Strike. Who cares? Might as well. 4 damage, whatever. He's not going to win with Malygos. He's going to win just with anything. Just with stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Stuff's my favorite.
I love stuff.
Same.
And this is when you know that they're desperate, is when they just empty their hand. And I think Dog still has a way to clear this with Blade Flurry, so... SI Agent...
If he didn't before, he definitely does now. He actually wants to get rid of this Gadget Stand Auctioneer, I think, at this point. He's getting a little bit low on deck size. And
yeah, everything that he would need.
Yeah, he just doesn't need anything else. Yeah, 3 guards left. I don't think he wants to draw anymore.
So many options.
My eyes are... Yeah, well, I was wrong. He doesn't want to draw some more, but not going to actually play a spell this turn, it looks like.
Who cares? 14 health, heal the Gadget Stand. 14 health, 9 cards, whatever. I'll take it. Yeah, I guess he knows that there's just not going to be anything else. Zalae's going to have to tap every turn. Dog's going to be playing minions that are much stronger every single turn. Zalae's just going to go ahead and tap out of the game. That means Dog's up 3-1 in the series. He's going to be on match point moving forward.
Yeah, this is brutal stuff. I mean, just back-to-back games where Dog has quite literally killed every single minion that Zalae has played. And that's one of those demoralizing feelings is when you try to get something rolling and your opponent just has the answer to every single spot. That's the one situation I feel like where Zalae could potentially be affected mentally. And down 3-1, he's got to beat Druid to do it too. And 3 chances for Druid to just get one of those amazing draws where it just does Druid things.
Good odds.
This is going to be a tough one.
Yeah. Effectively, you can look at this as being 2-0 up in a best of 5 for Dog. Since that's how it translates over into a best of 7. Dog just has to win 1. Zalae has to win 3 in a row. So Zalae's going to throw out that Hobgoblin Zoo deck one more time. It's probably got the best chance against Druid. and we'll see if he can do it. But I'm liking Doc's hand right now. He doesn't have spells to fight early on. The shade's a little bit awkward. But having that wild growth into a 4-drop is a good hand. It's not the nuts, but it's a good hand.
Something Zalay was missing from the last two games, too, I think, was early Nerubian Eggs. And against Druid, the Nerubian Eggs can be a threat, but it's kind of like the one card that if Druid has an answer to it, it stalls your almost your entire game. You know, you play Nerubian Egg, if they have the silence for it, I usually feel like I'm in trouble when that happens. And when I'm playing as the Druid and I silence a Nerubian Egg, I usually feel like I'm in pretty good shape.
Yeah. So I think Soleil was hoping to pick up an activator here. You know, most other Zoo decks would just play the Argent Squire, but since, one, Soleil has both eggs in his hand, and two, Soleil also is running a Hobgoblin version, so Argent Squire gets more value as the game goes on, I think he is pretty happy with just searching for an activator, being able to plop down an egg the next turn, and wow, so Soleil's going to be able to go off on turn six.
Is it going to be enough by then, though?
Yeah, that's the question.
Yep, Nerubian Egg's the play, and he's running right into what Dog has.
I must safeguard.
There, the paper looked like it went face. Like the arrow was pointed at the face. Yeah, I was pausing for a second. I was like, that's not where he wanted to go.
Yeah, I'm not sure about that one. Second Nerubian Egg, still no activator though, and that's really the big one.
Yeah. And now what do you do? Your hand is full of like combo pieces, so to speak. So, gets rid of the Echoing Ooze. I'm not sure how happy he is about that. But even if you don't have an activator, you're always threatening activator. The Nerubian Egg is always sort of, you have to keep that in the back of your mind when you're playing against it. So that might be playing into Dog's head a little bit here. He's thinking, well, what's the better play I can make if he has Powerful Warming? What's the better play that I can make if he has, you know, an Abusive Sergeant? And Sludge Belch is the play here, because if he does have Abusive Sergeant, it means that he can't necessarily trade in efficiently into the Sludge Belcher.
Yeah, it's like going to look for the the right sequence here, but all of them look pretty tough. And that's really the thing about Druid, too, is like if it stalls the board development and doesn't fall way far behind, it usually just stays ahead.
Yeah.
And so that's what Zalay's looking for, is how does he actually swing this back in his favor? And it's like a mystery almost. Like, I have no idea how. I guess taunting up the eggs and trying to buy some more time. So pretty good. I don't really see these other two attacking pretty much ever. Mm.
Yeah. How much time is he going to be able to buy, though?
Dog picks up Big Game Hunter as well. So that Sea Giant, it's pretty much taken care of at this point, too. And I think that's what Zalay was kind of eyeing, was building into the Sea Giant turn.
Yeah, but I think this is a Hobgoblin turn. I don't know if you're going to be able to get much value. That's going to be a 3-3 with Divine Shield put on the board, and a 3-5 Taunt put on the board. Basically, a Stended Shieldmaster and a Silver Moon Guardian, which are both 4 mana cards, each 1 mana.
Yeah, pretty good. Plus the threat of the Hobgoblin down. I mean, this isn't like something that Dog just wants to ignore. Like, he needs to find some way to check that Hobgoblin, in his mind anyway.
Mm-hmm. Zalay's just praying right now. No swipe. Swipe is almost a full board clear here. Swipe plus a hero power would clear everything off the board except for the Argent Squire. Actually, no, he'd probably kill the Argent Squire. Everything off the board except for a 1 health Defender of Argus.
Yeah, it's going to be draw 2 instead, and that is great news for Zalay right now. Yeah, this is definitely the kind of position that can get out of hand.
That it is. All right, so...
It's not what he wanted to draw, but...
If he taps his turn, there's no way that he can play Sea Giant, but I think Gormok's to play anyway. How much damage is that, actually? 8, 10, plus 6 is... 15, plus 4 is 20. So, I mean, I still think you just Gormok, trade in the Dark Peddler and the Divine Shielded Argent Squire and the Ancient of Lore, and just start going face again. I mean, that's the cleanest it's going to get. And you still have a resilient board, you're not weak to swipe. Oh, he's actually just going to trade off his 1 mana, or sorry, 1 health.
playing around the top deck swipe, which I actually think is really smart here. I think it's one of the ways he loses this game. His board presence is so heavy that he didn't really need to play the Sea Giant. Force Danger, Innervate, Savage Roar are going to help clean up some of this stuff, but goodness, the damage is going to keep pouring on. I mean, Zalay might have turned the corner, honestly, with the Hobgoblin turn, and Dog not having the swipe to take care of it.
This is actually quite a bit that's going to be cleared off. He's going to be able to clear the Gormok. He's going to be able to clear the Hobgoblin. Unfortunately, the Living Runes doesn't really have a use. He can Living Runes off the Divine Shield, but that's just about the only thing, the only use that it's going to have. It's just not really a clean way to go about it. Like, there's not clean ways to remove all of this stuff.
Yeah, there's no utility back behind either, so this is just there's nothing really to give here. Now it falls to 11 even from this attack. Time waits for no one. You know, at this point, you just got to hope that Zalay's hand is fairly dead, which is just not a very good hope.
Yeah. So Living Runes for the 1-1s. And, yeah, it's just going to pray. Power overwhelming. It's That's 9. 2 damage off, yeah.
I think you tap here. Ranker Z. Hey, that one's all right.
Yeah, that pretty much just locks up the game.
Ancient War would be a good draw here from Dog, but pretty much outside of that, it is looking like he can be done. Whoa, Ancient
Hello.
Of War!
Does that give him a shot? I still don't think it really gives him a shot. There's still so many outs here for Lethal because Power of a Woman... Oh no, Power of a Woman wouldn't allow him to cleanly push through. So, I mean it's better than nothing.
I mean, say he draws another taunt back behind this. This is a potential recovery.
Yeah. It could be, but it's still looking very poor. Very poor.
I think Zalay wants to go for... He doesn't want to go for Sea Giant here, honestly, but I think he has to, given this hand texture. Yeah, this is going to be met with the Big Game Hunter. The Power Overwhelming pushes 3 damage as well.
I don't know. He's going to need a spell because 3 damage is going to be pushed through. And even after the Big Game Hunter, there's going to be 5 damage left on board. Even like a swipe won't even...
It's a taunt.
Clear. A taunt? Ancient of Lore, that's a heal. Oh, that keeps him alive. Oh, jeez. And that's both Power Overwhelming's gone. So now we're like a charger away. Does this deck even run chargers as finishers?
No, it doesn't. We've seen the full 30 cards. 2 Power Overwhelming.
Yeah, that's right.
That's the enhancement.
Yeah. But I don't know if you know, Dog's going to find a way to deal with a Sea Giant. He's going to need a lot of help off the top. But then at that point, Zalay's sort of got to make the decision, hey, do I start removing the board to protect my Sea Giant and sort of go all in on it? Like, what's the decision here? If he goes face, then that means there's some clean trades here, and he can leave it with only the Sea Giant, but then all of a sudden a spell loses you the game, a taunt makes it rough for you.
An implosion like, how do you go might about lock it up. That implosion was a really good draw. Now, if he rolls 2, he actually can't play the Sea Giant this turn.
Yeah.
I'm guessing the implosion's going to be pointed at the Big Game Hunter.
Yeah, he needs to roll a 3 or higher, though, in order for him to still be able to play, because it'll take 1 off and add 3, so it'll effectively reduce the Sea Giant by another 2, so it would cost 3 mana. Oh, so he's going to take, I guess, the safer route. Hello!
That's a pretty good one. I wonder if this is ever trade here. I think you go face. Yeah, trading the 3-3 I think is fine. He's going to trade everything.
He's only going to get 1 ooze.
This comes down to Dog having to have an answer to this. I mean, the extra 8-8 is just...
Ooh!
Well, we'll be at 1.
1 health, but can Zalay piece together 2 damage? Abusive Sergeant does it. Power Overwhelming, but I don't think he has any left. Maybe a Dark Peddler into a Power Overwhelming Abusive Sergeant.
Oh,
Knife Juggler.
This game is crazy.
Explosion could do it.
Oh,
Woodwalker protects it. Woodwalker does protect it. Oh, man.
Oh,
this
my
is
gosh.
Too close.
8 damage crashing in. Dog needs help off the top, too. The Juggler even goes face. He's down to 1.
Force of Nature. That's a full clear. That is a full clear. Oh no.
Oh my god.
Oh no, does Soleil have one damage? The dog just puts his hands up there and goes, oops, sorry. Oh man, oh. Argent Squire.
This could be like the sickest comeback.
At one health, and Soleil is just, you can tell that he just looks annoyed.
Dog needs multiple attacks to clear this off. He needs four attacks to be able to clear through this. Big jump to the claw! Oh my gosh!
And there's nothing that pushes through. I don't know. Do you play it safe and maybe just clear off the end game boss, or
base.
Because an owl kills you.
There is
you,
an Iron Gala in there, isn't there?
Yeah. So he needs 1, 2, 3, 4 attacks to clear up the whole board, but he can. No, yeah, an Iron Beak Owl is you're dead no matter what. So maybe you just go face here.
No, he's not dead no matter what. If he clears off both of the... If he attacks M. King Boss with the first Shredder and attacks the one with the second Shredder, Iron Beak Owl is going to leave him at 1 if he doesn't attack the Divine Shield here. So this is it. Iron Beak Owl is needed for Zalay right now.
Oh my goodness. He hopes, he prays, well...
That's going to buy him a turn.
But I don't know. Is there still any ways that he can find a win here? I must
safeguard. How about Keeper of the Grove? That's going to do it. Dog fights his way back from 1 HP.
And yes,
takes
he does.
Game number 5. Oh my gosh, TJ. I can't believe Dog won this game.
Wow. What? That, like, I was writing that game off from, like, turn 6. I was like, there is no way that Dog is going to find a way to make it out of this one. And at 1 health for multiple turns in a row, that Hobgoblin deck showing maybe a slight weakness if the board is removed with no chargers. Nothing left to sort of add that extra damage. But that force... I just don't even know. I don't even know how to sum that one up.
I'm stunned right now. I mean, it's like such a good sequence of draws too. Being able to clear, have the heal, draw the force nature, put the taunt up, get use of the shredders that had been in his hand like the entire game. Oh my gosh, that's a heartbreaking loss for Zalay, but wow, what a comeback from Dog.
Yeah, and that means Dog is going to be moving on to the PAX Prime Finals. He will join Eversiction as the second player to win a feature and to get that automatic seed into the grand finals at PAX Prime in August. He'll also go away with $3,000 to add to that impressive tournament winnings that he has. Of course, Zalay will go home with 1,500 plus 16 Geico points, which is actually a lot. So if he manages to place maybe in one of the opens, he is a U.S.-based player, so he is allowed to compete in those opens. He can gather some Geico points and maybe piece together a finish for later in the season and qualify himself there. But I don't think he can be too disappointed with his performance throughout the weekend because I think he played well. It looks like his preparation was there. He just couldn't manage to bring it there in the finals.
Yeah, second place is going to sting today. But tomorrow when he goes, I got $1,500.
$1,500, yeah.
It'll feel a lot better tomorrow.
Yeah, he should be pretty happy with that. But big congratulations to Dog. We want to give you guys another reminder. We will be at PAX East. Owenog and Geico will be at PAX East in just a week's time. There will be a major happening there with a $10,000 prize pool and 43 Hearthstone Championship Tour points to give away. There's going to be a lot of great players that are already going to be there. There's also going to be an open portion. There's 128 slots open. It's on-site signups only, so you have to actually be at PAX East. But if you're going to be there and you think you have what it takes, then make sure you head over to the booth and sign up for that. There's also going to be some players there from Team Liquid, from Archon, from Cloud9. If you want to get some stuff signed, it's going to be a great time. That will be broadcast on Twitch as well, right on this channel. So make sure if you're not going to PAX East that you tune in because it's going to be a fantastic time. That's 22nd through the 24th, so next week. But Admiral, I mean, that was an exciting day. Do you have any final words, any shout-outs, any closing thoughts that you'd like to give?
Just thanks to all the fans who joined us today for these great games. And, you know, maybe a little bit of extra sting there for Zalay. Dog is now up 3-2 against them lifetime in series. Right? Mm-hmm. But, man, what just such great play today. I mean, we saw very little, if any, real mistakes being made. You know, just a couple of tighter sequence plays. But outside of that, we're just picture-perfect Hearthstone today.
Yeah, it was a great day. We do want to give a huge shout out to the sponsors, Geico, the title sponsor for the 2016 circuit, as well as the Video Game Voters Network, and of course, a Cyber Power PC. We are still doing that giveaway, so make sure when you're signing up for the Open Tournament, the next Open on April 30th, you also enter in to win that PC on geico.onog.gg. Once again, thank you everybody for tuning in. Admirable, it was a blast getting to cast you once again. Thanks everybody for watching, and we'll see you next week right here for the Major. Thanks for watching.